Dear Heavenly Father, we have already expressed our thanksgiving for sparing our lives up to this moment and for bringing us here tonight again. We pray for those that are still on the way. We pray that your Holy Spirit will be received and expected in every heart so that we will be willing to surrender to the truths, the principles of the kingdom of God that he will teach us. Give us hearts that are also away from everything else of the world. Calm down anything, any noise that will be in our minds, and help us to just listen carefully as we receive from your word the things that you have left for us. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, to review our memory verses, tonight we are reviewing the first part, the first half. And so we begin with Matthew 1:21. Thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. The next one is 2 Peter 3:13. Nevertheless, we, according to his promises, look for new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Hebrews 9:28. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. Yes. The next one is Philippians 3:9. On that day, we want to be how? Be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the faith which is of God by faith. Pardon me, the righteousness which is of God by faith. All right. From the same chapter, Philippians 3, verse 3, and we're going to hear some echoes of this later on tonight. For we are the circumcision, which worship God in the Spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh. Amen. Hebrews 11:17 to 19, talking about Abraham and the faith that led him to do what he did. By faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac. And he who had received the promises offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called, accounting that God was able to raise him up even from the dead, from whence also he received him in a figure. So that is the last one in the first half. However, let us review the last one that we had added, which is Romans 5:20 and 21. Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. But where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. For what? That as sin hath reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ, our Lord. Very good. I hope that everybody is having an easy time at repeating those, and keep on feeding. The Holy Spirit will do his part to get those attached to our brains and to bring them back when we need them. For those that might have joined in later in our course, you might be hit right in the face with, 12, however many, I don't even know how many we have, memory verses. And you might feel like, oh my goodness, I'm never going to catch up. Do not worry about that. Just take some and begin reviewing them, as you're driving, as you are waiting at a doctor's office. God will open all kinds of ideas and ways in which you can also memorize it. And remember, it is not your doing. It is the doing of the Holy Spirit in your mind, regardless of how easy or how difficult memorizing might have been the rest of your life, or how old you are now. It doesn't matter. The Holy Spirit has no limitations. So remember that and let him do it. All right, we are ready then to get into our book. Last time, we have finished chapter 29. However, we were going to return to look at that reference, reference number 9, which is at the top of page 150. So in order to catch the whole flavor of what it was that it was talking about, let's turn in our Bibles to Galatians 3. Galatians 3:19. Galatians in the New Testament, after Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Acts, and Romans, 1st, 2nd Corinthians, and then you have a bunch of little letters, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. All right, Galatians 3, verse 19. And it reads thus, "Wherefore then serveth the law?" In other words, what is the meaning? What is the purpose of the law then? And here comes the reason why we have that footnote. "It was added because of transgressions, till the seed should come to whom the promise was made. And it was ordained by angels in the hand of a mediator." A lot of what is there in that text we already studied in the chapter itself. But that little word there, it was added because of transgression. Because there are people then that are hanging on to that and saying, see, then that was not part of the covenant and promises that God had made to Abraham. Now he comes 450, somewhere in there, years later, and he adds something. But you cannot do that to a contract. You cannot amend it, take off, add on at any time at your leisure. No. So why would God do that? He wouldn't. So we want to understand exactly what it is that is saying there. The footnote is in page 149 itself. So we're going to go and read it again and then do a little bit more of studying of that. It says, "Some have thought to build an argument on the word added, supposing that it indicates something entirely new added to the provisions which God had previously made." So now it takes us to another place in the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible, the book of Deuteronomy. And in Deuteronomy 5:22, it says, but let me read what it says there. "It will show the sense in which it is used," that word added, right? "After having rehearsed the Ten Commandments, Moses said," and this is what is in Deuteronomy 5:22, "those words the Lord spake unto all your assembly in the mount out of the midst of the fire, of the cloud, and of the thick darkness, with a great voice, and he added no more." What happened there? Why does it say that? It doesn't mean then also that even at that time they were saying, okay, he was adding something. No, the meaning of the word added there is God was talking, saying all these things, and then he stopped. He didn't add anything else. He didn't speak anymore. He stopped talking, in other words, right? So do we understand the meaning of what is being said there? So when it says he didn't add anymore, it doesn't mean that he was adding all the time. No, he was speaking and he didn't say anything else after that. All right, continue then in the little paragraph at the bottom of 149. That is, he spoke so much and he spoke no more. The same thing is shown even more plainly in Hebrews 12, 18 and 19. You know, it is printed there, but I want us to go in our Bible so that you can also underline or circle that word so that you will keep record of what it is that you have understood and be able to remember it later and maybe share it with somebody else. Hebrews 12, 18 and 19. Again here, it is a recount of what had happened at Sinai. And you already heard some of these, you know, with the voices and the fire and all of that. Okay, so 18 and 19. "For ye are not come unto the mount that might be touched, and that burnt with fire, nor unto blackness and darkness and tempest and the sound of a trumpet and the voice of words, which voice they that heard entreated that the word should not be spoken to them anymore. See the word there, the word that says spoken? That word is the same as the word added. It comes from the same word in the Greek. So it's used interchangeably. That word is used interchangeably. So in fact, if you go, if you have Galatians 3:19, find it again, and you look at both of these texts, verse 19 in both of them, 3:19 and Hebrews 12:19, you will see there. It says, wherefore, what is the purpose of the prophet of the law? It was added because of the transgressions. In other words, it was spoken because of the transgressions. And we'll come back a little bit more to that matter of the transgressions. But for now, just stop there and then go back to Hebrews 12:19. And let's see. And the sound of a trumpet and of the voice of words, which voice they heard, entreated that the word should not be spoken to them anymore or added to them anymore. They did not want to hear it anymore. Don't say anymore. Why did they not want to hear anymore? Well, it's been telling us there in those references that the scene at Sinai that day that God spoke the law from the top of Mount Sinai, it was a scene like we haven't seen or heard. It talks about the sound of trumpet and the voice of words, God's voice speaking. Well, we had a storm go by this evening. It wasn't as bad as I've heard them before, but have you heard loud, loud, really loud thunder? The kind that makes wives just go real close to their husbands at night and kind of try to hide from those, bam, it sounds like a bunch of wood is falling right on top of another, right? Imagine the voice of God speaking from the top of a mountain. And so then after that, they said, Moses, you go, you talk to God, and you come back and tell us what he says. We don't want to hear it anymore. That's the meaning of that. Now, in a sense, God was adding, but not adding more. The law was not known by Adam and Eve and Noah and Methuselah and Abraham. Everybody knew that you should not kill, that you should not lie, that you should not commit adultery, that you should treat your parents honorably, that you should not take the name of the Lord in vain, and you go on right down the line. It wasn't that God was just telling them for the first time, that it was just, he was just coming up with something right off from his sleeve. No. Not at all. It says that it was added. Let's finish reading now the paragraph at the bottom of 149. And it says the Greek word rendered spoken in this instance is identical with that rendered added in Galatians 3:19. That's why we wanted to compare those two. I went to my good old humongous friend called the Strong's Concordance. The Strong's Concordance is a book in which you will find every single word that there is in the Bible. Every single word in the King James. Every single word. So being that that's what it says there, I went to my friend and I said, well, let me see. He said, do these two things come from the same word? You go in and you look at the word added, and it tells you that that came from, and it gives you a number. The number is 4369. At the end of the concordance, there are two sections. One in which you will find all the words that are said in the Old Testament, which those came from the Hebrew and Aramaic. Those were the original sources of those books. So you, it will give you a number. You will go, if you're looking at the Old Testament, you will go to the section of the Old Testament and look for that number. If you are looking at a word like we are here, added and spoken from the New Testament, then you go to the New Testament section and you find there, as I told you, number 4369. That is the same number that you find for the word added of Galatians 3:19. Number 4369. The word is a Greek word, and it is, for those Greek people among us, prosthemi. Prosthemi. That is the word. It's used in both cases there. All right, let's go back to that little note at the bottom of 149, because I promise we will come back to that other little piece of that. It says, so the question, what was the use of the law since it made no change in the covenant? The answer is, it was spoken because of transgression. What transgression is it spoken about there? What is it referring to by this transgression? Well, remember that the law, we find it was given there in Exodus chapter who? Chapter 20. Yes, in Exodus chapter 20. And if you remember, we have studied Exodus chapter 19 before. What happened in chapter 19 that this is referring to? Well, let's go there. Exodus chapter 19. I'm going to look it up and everybody's going to go, oh, yeah, I remember that. Exodus 19. At Exodus 19, they had already been taken out from Egypt. They had already been walking in the desert for a while, oh, about about 10 weeks or so, I believe it was. At any rate, God comes to them in chapter 19, and you can read that again, and he says to them, okay, you saw, verse four, ye have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bear you on eagle's wings and brought you unto myself. And so he's bringing all that he has done, which everyone in the people of Israel in that big multitude had not only known, but had seen with their own eyes, all the plagues, the crossing of the Red Sea, everything else. You remember all that study, right? That we had done in the first part of this book. So God is saying now, can you trust me? You remember all that I have done? Think about it. And then now move forward with me. Would you allow me now to make you a holy nation, a special people? And so Moses went and talked to them. And the answer from them is in verse 8. Let's look at verse 8. When Moses told them what God had said, it says there, and all the people answered together and said, all that the Lord has spoken, we will do. Is that what God had told them? Are they able to make themselves holy? Are they able themselves to make their nation a pure and separate and very special nation? No, they couldn't even get themselves out of slavery by themselves, let alone make themselves into anything else. So they missed what God was trying to say to them. Based on what I've shown you, would you please allow me now to do this? I have more plans for you than just cross the Red Sea and start walking in the desert and then get the manna and get the water and get this and get the other. I have much more for you, greater plans. You haven't begun to see all that I have planned for you. Oh, okay, okay, Lord. Yeah, all that you tell us, that's exactly what we're gonna do. No, they couldn't any more than we can, right? And so God decides the only way that he is going to be able to get through to them is to allow them then to hear what the promises that he had and see if they can do them. What are those promises? Well, we're going to study about that tonight. That's the Ten Commandments. So because of the transgressions, God had to now use his voice. And not only that, because then he gave the tables of the commandments to Moses. And so now they had them written and they had heard them. Plus they had known about them already before. So that is why it says there, because of the transgressions. God wanted them to know. Okay, so now we're going to move on to chapter 30. And more is going to come right along with that and hopefully make it even plainer, clearer. Chapter 30, the promises to Israel, Sinai, and Calvary. This is a chapter which was an article written for the Present Truth of November 26, 1896. The first paragraph there comes from Malachi 4, 5, and 6. I know it is printed there, but let's go look at it in the Bible, because then you can underline it and circle it and whatever else is. And I'll tell you what, you will see why you want that to be emphasized. Okay, Malachi is the last book of the Old Testament. So if you don't know how to get there, go to Matthew and back up. Malachi, and I think it only has four chapters. Yep. Malachi chapter 4, verses 5 and 6. Okay. Malachi 4, 5 and 6. And it says, behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. What is the function? What is the reason why he will be sending Elijah? Verse 6, and he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite thee the earth with a curse. Now let's go back now to the book. Please underline it. I want to give you enough time to do that. And the reason why I wanted you to do that is because there is so much hope and encouragement and faith building to families in these last days. Do we need the hearts of the parents to be turned to the children and the hearts of the children to be turned to the parents? We need it more than at any other time. There is so much wickedness, so much disrespect, so much abuse, so much fatherlessness and motherlessness and drug and everything else that God needs to send a special message for families that is going to redeem them and bring them together in preparation for the coming of Jesus, the great and dreadful day of the Lord. God doesn't want to come back and then find the families in shambles. Nobody's ready. Everybody's lost. No, he wants to make sure to send a special message that will be able to open the hearts of the parents and the children to one another. So there might be in our midst, or we know somebody else whose family is just falling apart. There's pain, there's sorrow, there's all kinds of abuse and syndromes of all kinds. Is God able to bring restoration and healing to all of those? Yes, he is. If not, let's just lie down and go to sleep. Go to die, in other words, right? There's no hope then. The last part of the paragraph, after it quotes Malachi 4, 5, and 6, it says, or literally with utter destruction. So it's not curse. I smite the earth with a curse. The curse, as we know, a jinx or something like that. No, literally means with utter destruction. God doesn't want to have any families that will be destroyed along with the rest of the destruction that his coming will bring. Let's go then to the second paragraph. Notice how intimately the tender, converting work of the Spirit of God is connected with the law that was spoken from Horeb. For Sinai is Horeb. Sinai is Horeb. Maybe you should underline that. As we learn from Deuteronomy 4, 10 to 14, where we read the words of Moses, the servant of God. That's the next paragraph. Let's read together. Thou stoodest before the Lord thy God in Horeb. Okay, what happened there? When the Lord said unto me, gather me the people together, and I will make them hear my words. And ye came near and stood under the mountain, and the mountain burned with fire under the midst of heaven, with darkness, clouds, and thick darkness. Oh, we read that before tonight, right? We already read some description like that. Continuing, and the Lord spake unto you out of the midst of the fire, and he declared unto you his covenant, which he commanded you to perform, even 10 commandments. And he wrote them upon 2 tables of stone. And the Lord commanded me at that time to teach you statutes and judgments, that ye might do them in the land whither you go over to possess it. So what is it that happened at Horeb? Well, what happened at Sinai? Because Sinai and Horeb are one and the same. As far as a location and a geographical point, those two are one and the same. Just two names for it. Next paragraph. When the Lord tells us to remember the law, which he commanded in Horeb, or Sinai, it is that we may know what. Please underline. Oh, how beautiful. Here it is in regards to why we read Malachi. It is that we may know the power with which he will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, that they may be prepared for the terrible day of his coming. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. Psalm 19:7. Next section, titled The Riven Rock. When God spoke the law from Sinai, or Horeb, right? We just learned that. That living stream of water which gushed from the smitten rock in Horeb, remember? When God told Moses, because they had no water and everybody was complaining and murmuring, oh, you brought us out here to die of thirst. We and our children, even our cattle. And so the Lord said to Moses, take your rod, go by the rock and hit the rock with the rod one time. And what happened? Water came out from the rock. And that was the water that they had right through the rest of the years that they were wandering around in the desert. There was water always there for them. So now that's what we're talking about here. Continuing. That water was still flowing. If it had ceased to flow, the Israelites would have been in a bad condition, as bad a condition as before, for it was their only water supply, their only hope of life. It was from Horeb, whence the water came that restored their life, that God spoke the law. The law came from the same rock whence the water was already flowing, and that rock was Christ. 1 Corinthians 10:4, let's go there. 1 Corinthians, New Testament, again, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Acts, Romans, 1 and 2 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 10, verse 4. You may want to underline that in your Bibles as well. And did all drink the same spiritual drink? For they drank of that spiritual rock, capital R, that followed them. And that rock was Christ. So the same giver of the law was the one that gave them the water. And the one that had given them the manna too, right? It's all from God. All from Jesus, Christ, the sustainer of all things, right? Next paragraph on page 152, Sinai is rightly regarded as a synonym for the law, but it is no more so than Christ is. Nay, not so much, for in him it is life. Jesus said, quote, I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yeah, thy law is within my heart. Psalms 40, verse 8. The law was therefore Christ's life, for out of the heart are the issues of life, according to Proverbs 4:23. We have read the words that we're going to read in the next paragraph. Remember when we read from Isaiah chapter 53? All about this, the suffering servant? Here is some of that again. He was bruised for our iniquities, and with his stripes we are healed. When he was smitten and wounded on Calvary, the life blood flowed from his heart, and that stream still flows for us. But in his heart is the law. And so as we drink by faith from the life-giving stream, we drink in the righteousness of the law of God. The law comes to us as a stream of grace, a river of life. Both grace and truth came by Jesus Christ, according to John 1:17. When we believe in him, the law is not to us merely the voice of words, but a fountain of life. Let's go back again to Isaiah 53, verse 5. That was quoted there at the beginning of that paragraph. Isaiah 53, verse 5. We remember that when we read that, we had actually started on chapter 52, because that's where it begins to talk about the suffering servant, right? So Isaiah 53, verse 5. And this, my dears, is your next memory verse, Isaiah 53:5. It's such beautiful words. It puts it so well what Jesus did for us. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Isaiah 53:5. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All right, back to page 152, the next paragraph. Now, all this was at Sinai. Christ, the giver of the law, was the rock smitten in Horeb, which is Sinai. The stream was the life of those who drank, and none of those who received it in thoughtful gratitude could fail to know that it came directly from their Lord, the Lord of all the earth. They might have been assured of his tender love for them and of the fact that he was their life and hence their righteousness. So although they could not approach the mountain without dying, an evidence that the law is death to men out of Christ, underline that there, right? The law is death to men, to human beings that are out of Christ. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord, right? So if you don't have Christ, you don't have the gift of eternal life. You have death. Okay, continuing then. They could drink of the stream that flowed from it, and thus in the life of Christ, drink in the righteousness of the law. The words spoken from Sinai, coming from the same rock whence came the water, which was the life of the people, showed the nature of the righteousness that Christ would impart to them. He wanted to share it with them. While it was a fiery law, It was at the same time a gentle flowing stream of life. Because the prophet Isaiah knew that Christ was the rock smitten at Sinai, and that even then he was the one mediator, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. He, the prophet Isaiah, could say he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes, we are healed. Please underline the next paragraph. Here comes a very wonderful summary. For the ancient Israelites, there was emphasized the lesson that the law comes as life to men only through the cross of Christ. For us, there is the same lesson, together with the other side of it, namely, that the righteousness which comes to us through the life given to us on the cross is precisely that which is required by the Ten Commandments and none other. None other. So we have both the water of life and the bread of life, right? That is both from Sinai and Horeb. There you have the water that flowed and the words of God. Didn't Jesus say, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. That's what exactly happened at Sinai, right? Okay, so let us read them. Now, let me ask a question here. Are we saved by the law then? Good, I see heads shaking. No. Were they saved by the law? No, neither. Neither of us could, right? We are not saved by the law. They were never saved by the law. Nope. Nobody can be saved by the law. If they could, what did Jesus come for, right? All right. What God spoke. And now we're going to read the Ten Commandments. And of course, these are found where? In Exodus chapter 20. Right? We're going to read them from the book as you have them there, but you know where to go back and correlate them. Make sure that they're all there. Don't take anybody's word for it. First commandment, I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Do you notice there? We read in Exodus 19, how God said to Moses, tell them, you have seen how I took you out of the house of bondage, out of Egypt, and how I dealt with your enemies, and I have brought you. He begins the words of the Ten Commandments of his law exactly with the same preamble. Look, you have seen, you know what I have done. You already have the sample of what I am able to do and the desire that I have to do it for you. Can you trust me? Can you trust me with something else? I have more for you. Here it is. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Have we been, you and I, and now to them there, he's talking about Egypt. Have we been brought out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage? Let's not think, oh, I've never been a slave. Think again. Slave to sin, right? Did Jesus bring us out from there? Thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sin. Yes, it's the same Jesus that spoke the law. It's the same one that died on the cross for us to save us from our sins. So he has all the right to say to us, look, this is what I'm able to do. Would you allow me to do it in you? So what follows here, let's hear them not as you should do this and you should do that and you better do this or else. No, it's look, this is all that I have done. Here is the rest of what I promised to do for you. We're about to read 10 promises. The first one says, thou shalt have no other gods before me. God promises that. Second, thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image. Why would you want to do that, right? Nor any likenesses of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquities of the fathers upon the children, unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Third commandment, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. Fourth commandment, we can repeat this from memory. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth and the sea and all that in them is, and rested on the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Fifth commandment, honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Sixth, thou shalt not kill. Seventh, thou shalt not commit adultery. Eighth, thou shalt not steal. Ninth, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Tenth, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his ass, not anything that is thy neighbor's. We'd like to point out there that in every one of those, we can hear the voice of God adding that, I promise you will not do this. I promise you shall not kill. I promise you shall not bear false testimony, false witness against your neighbor, which means lie, right? Also in the sixth commandment, in the seventh, thou shalt not commit adultery. Let's remember that means moral purity. It's not just for married people, right? It's for every human being. God promises to make us and keep us morally clean, morally pure. All right. There is a footnote, but we're going to keep it for later on. Let's keep on reading, please. This is the law that was uttered. Well, maybe not. It's 8 o'clock already. So I guess we're going to stop there and we'll come back to this next time. Oh, what did I do with my pencil? All right. Let us then kneel for prayer as we close our lesson for tonight. Okay. Precious Heavenly Father, how wonderful to remember again and to allow our minds to expound, to sit around and listen, to let all of this come in into our minds and sip in a little at a time, to reflect upon all the blessings and the promises, the precious promises that you have made to us. You didn't have to, but your love would not have allowed you to do otherwise. And so we pray that we will understand your character of love more and more, so that it will be easy for us to understand why you want to implant all of these characteristics of your own character in us. We're talking about the hearts of the parents to be turned to the children and the hearts of the children to the parents. Lord, that is what you want to do, and it is through implanting your character in the parents and in the children, how they are going to be able to be joined and united together and be prepared for the day of your coming. May that day come soon. May we allow you to prepare us for it. In Jesus' name, amen.